For some people, OCD definitely does seem to run in the family. I'm on my way to meet one such couple in Cornwall. Eric lives on a small holding with dozens of rescued animals. His wife, Joyce, is a former office administrator who has a morbid fear of the spread of contaminants inside her house.
I'm just cleaning my shopping because I'm not comfortable putting it into the fridge unless I feel it's been cleaned. These are now ready to go in the cupboard because they've been decontaminated. So they can go in the cupboard.
In Joyce's family, OCD has been passed on in what appears to be a genetic link with disastrous consequences.
Good morning, Mr. Richardson.
I'm John, nice to meet you. How are you?
Yeah, welcome. Do you come in?
Thank you very much. Thanks for having us.
Ideally, coat off.
Right.
Ideally, if you're not going to be cold.
No, that's fine.
Right.
You have a warm house. You have a lovely house.
Oh, we've got a nice warm house.
Thank you very much.
And then shoes off at the door.
Shoes off at the door?
Shoes off at the door, and then you can come in. Basically, when we come in, if we've been doing something out, we have to bath and change into clean clothes. Then we are free to do what we like in the house. We have a barrier, an invisible barrier between the contaminated and the uncontaminated section. It's just at the door threshold, right?
Yes.
Come in very carefully. As long as you don't touch things, you're all right. Right.
Joyce believes it's no accident that she's developed severe OCD.
This is what I call my office. You see, my father. Brilliant solicitor, absolutely brilliant. Had his own practice in Whitehall. He was said to be a very obsessional man. He very clearly had it, and it's broke his marriage to my mother. It's obvious from my family that this has just been handed down from generation to generation. That was me, see?
Oh, wow.
Joyce developed her OCD when she became pregnant with her son, Martin. Her symptoms were so severe that she was unable to raise him. 20 years later, while he was at university, Martin was also diagnosed with OCD.
He got a double first class honours degree because he's absolutely brilliant.
Wow.
Yeah, double first class honours. He then went on to Oxford to do a PhD, and it came on during his first year at Oxford. It more or less stopped his studies in their tracks. That is Martin's thesis, right, from Oxford. This shows the mind of someone who is very, I don't understand a word of it. Mm. And they said he was well on the way to a PhD with this thesis.
He thanks someone for being patient during a difficult but hopefully ultimately successful year.
That was OCD.
That's it kicking in.
Here is the OCD. This is the turmoil in his mind. I have spent my life almost completely alone. My life is work and OCD. I'm riddled with OCD. He was pinning notes up all round the flat, trying to make sense of what was going on in his mind, trying to use his rational brain to work out what was wrong. And his OCD was so bad at that stage, he was quite unable to do anything. He could not. He'd become terrified of contaminating his sofa. He'd been terrified of scratching his sink. So he couldn't use his kitchen. He couldn't go and sit down. He couldn't lie down. And all he could do was pace, and he paced all day and all night.
What did he do?
Well, he went out, he bought himself a pair of kitchen scales and liquidizer. He went and cut yew branches. He liquidized it and drank it. Suicide was by yew poisoning. People close to me know the reason, so I won't elaborate, except to say I'm sorry for the pain caused. And I hope everyone recovers quickly. And goes on to live a happy and fulfilling life. Love, Martin. 4/12/07. People to inform. And then he's got a list of as OCD does, people to inform. To tell him that he's not there anymore. Sorry, John.
Don't be sorry at all.
Awful, isn't it?
Yeah.
Terrible. Dreadful. A victim of this horrible, horrible illness. Yeah, John, I'm all right with you touching paper because paper can't be washed.
Okay.
Not a problem.
Thanks. Cause of death, obsessive compulsive disorder.
This illness in its worst form kills. I think we were born with a time bomb ticking in our heads waiting to go, yes. I'd have rather not been born than have my son die like that. I'm sorry if that upsets you, because I know you have trouble that way.
I always assume it's something that can be dealt with. And I've never looked at it before as something that you're born with, that you always have it at some level. And, you know, it just makes you wonder, but for certain decisions you've made, what state you would be in.
I just hope it's not upset you, John. Not going to affect you.
It's so hard to hear someone say to you that it would be better if they'd never been born. There's an element in which the compulsions completely eradicate any joy, and they completely remove any sense of enjoyment of life. Martin clearly didn't feel he could find a life with enough happiness in it to cope with his OCD. But, you know, clearly people do. Through medication or people or whatever the balance is, you find a way of controlling it and not it controlling you.
Hey! Come on then, girl.
Despite the suicide of her son, Joyce and Eric have found a way of living with her OCD.
Come on then.
Outside of the house, Joyce is free from her fear of contaminants.
Free.
And caring for rescued animals gives them both some peace of mind.
On this journey, I've met people who undoubtedly will look at you with sadness in their eyes and tell you that they wish their lives were different and they wish they could do things differently but for these compulsions. And, you know, I'm not there. But there might be a few parts of my brain that function similar way, or maybe I get the same impulses at times. So it's time for me to find out once and for all whether I have quirks or obsessive compulsions.
I'm on my way to Bath University for an assessment with one of the country's leading experts in OCD.
If he tells me I've got diagnosed OCD, I don't think I'm quite prepared for the consequences. And it would, you know, I have a slight fear that things might get worse for me as I get older. And there's less pressure on me to control my compulsions as there is now. I am respectfully worried. I'm cautious, is what I am.
For my assessment, I have to fill in a series of questionnaires and then have an extended psychological interview with Professor Paul Shalkovskis.
I'm speculating, and I kind of want you to test this in your head, really, about whether or not getting things just right gives you some sort of sense of control.
That gives me a focus, I guess, because of the, you know, if you're not thinking about where you put your cutlery, then what are you thinking about?
2 hours later, and the assessment is complete. It's time for the verdict.
Okay, so, as it stands, I would say my diagnosis is that you've got some of the preoccupations that go along with OCD, or things like, you know, bodily fluids and stuff like that. You think about them rather more than other people do, so they're more in your head. And you are clearly a perfectionist. You're avoiding errors and mistakes. You're concerned about mistakes. You have really very high standards for yourself. In terms of how often you're experiencing these obsessional symptoms, they're actually occurring quite frequently. You've got a score of 53 in the clinical range. People who have obsessive compulsive disorder, that starts at 60. But the frequency is not the important thing. It's how much they upset or distress you and interfere with your life. And in terms of distress, you're way down on that. So you're actually at the kind of level, average level, of people who don't have OCD. And that's really the important thing, because when we talk about obsessive compulsive disorder, it's the disorder bit that defines it, the way it interferes with your life. And you haven't got that.
Yeah, I think that's all fair. So, yeah, I feel very fortunate about that. I feel relieved and sort of content with that, almost, that the things I'm doing, but at the moment they don't cause me any distress. And I would say two or three years ago, my distress levels would have been higher. But now, you know, I feel like I do elect to do most of the things I do, and I do them because they calm my anxiety. Hello, Salisbury. It's time... Yeah, why not? Whoa, a bit too much. It's time to restart the show. Please welcome to the stage, me! I find it incredible that before I started doing this, I'd never met anyone with diagnosed OCD. Now, I'm in no doubt whatsoever about how serious it can be and the effects that it has on your life can be totally negative. And I'm aware now that I'm very lucky that the things I do through choice, and my brain maybe works in a similar way to theirs, but I don't feel bad about it. And if I could have one wish for them, it would be that through treatment, they can get to the point I feel I'm at, that I feel I have obsessive compulsive order. So my brain works in a measured and meticulous way. I keep my forks a certain way and I smooth my margarine over, but I'm happy with that. It seems quite simple to me, all this, right? And yet I watch them wash off and they'll lay the cutlery flat on the drain.